Shaping change, managing the transformative power of impact producing and outreach in documentary filmmaking. I think there was a bit of a misprint in the program. We're not talking about tax incentives. I think that's what I need. We have no clue about these.
You can still leave this
So today we have with us from left to right Marek, a participant, Amy Shepherd from Film Impact Production, and Christine Marquez from Kinema. We'll be talking for about an hour, and then we'll open up for questions from the audience for the last 30 minutes or so. So if you have any questions, please keep them until the end. And maybe first I would like to start with, is there anybody here in the audience who is familiar with impact campaigns? Have any of you already done an impact campaign?
One, two, okay. So that's good, because I think we're here to sort of unpack everything that comes with an impact campaign. And we have both impact and outreach here in our title. So maybe let's sort of define, like, what do we talk about when we talk about impact and outreach? Maybe, Rory, do you want to maybe explain what it means for you?
Sure, I'll open it up with that. It's a big question. I think people define, can you hear me? People define them differently across the industry. It depends on the issue, the organization that you're working with. To me, impact, it is moving past inspiration when it comes to watching a film. It is taking action in some way, shape, or form. It can be on the individual level. It can be behavioral change, again, based on the issue, or it can be structural. It can be larger. It can be targeting legislation. It can be as big as you want. In terms of outreach, I think of engaging with partners. You know, once a film, I mean, it can be as early as the development inception stage, or it can be once it's complete. It's who's doing the work on the ground already. And so that outreach is key to the work that we do at Participant. I know that.
Amy, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, I'd agree with all of that. Films can be intrinsically impactful in the sense that they make you feel something that you've not felt, or they make you think about something that you've not thought about, or consider your perspective on a topic with which you might be familiar, but you might not have considered different perspectives. But then impact can also be that much more intentional level of an impact campaign that can take a film and use it for a transformational effect and use it in a change-making way.
Yeah. So maybe there's also a difference in an impactful film and an impact film?
I think you have to have the art for a film to be have a potential for an impact campaign. If your film is not intrinsically compelling and watchable, then it's very, very difficult for you to do anything with that, because your film needs to resonate with audiences. You need to, especially a feature film, if we're going to sit these days, everything is 30-second, 60-second content. If you're going to sit for a 90-minute film, you need to have a film that people can't turn their eyes away from the screen at that time. And that then also makes your audience then want to rise up and to do something, to come out of that cinema and to awaken into the bright light and to say, well, how do I get involved with this? Why is the situation still existing? Who is acting on this? Where does it go next? And to have that kind of burning, you know, maybe even anger sometimes about what they've just seen on screen.
Yeah, and I think we've talked about that sort of, it's a bit of a buzzword sometimes as well. So we all want impact. And I think a lot of us, and especially in documentary filmmaker, a lot of filmmakers think about this fact that when they're making a film, they want to create impact in the end. They are making a film often in order to create some social change. But how, for example, Christy, do you get involved in a film? So where do you come in, and when should people reach out to you?
So I want to weigh in a little bit on that outreach and impact stuff too, because it is different for different organizations and in different industries. So I run a company called Kinema now. We support community distribution and impact distributions as it relates to the topic here. I previously was at Participant, but like I really cut my teeth in that music at that main organization. But I also ran an impact agency called Picture Motion, and there we look at it as almost a funnel or upside-down triangle, where at the top would be kind of the outreach. That's the action that we as the organization are doing on behalf of the film. It's reaching out to the nonprofit organization, building partnerships, building websites, really kind of our motion doing it outward. Next after that was engagement. So what organizations would then engage with the film or support the film? And encourage people to take action, which is the next step, the action. So did someone actually do something afterwards? And for us, the impact was the outcome. So outreach to kind of build partnerships, have those partners engage with us to reach audiences, actually was the action the audiences would take in that direction of hopefully achieving impact. So that's how we looked at it. And we would get into different stages, to be honest, and everyone has kind of different opinions on this. We were like a third-party agency. We were not the filmmakers, we were not the distributors, and so we were typically for hire. And because budgets are so scarce and we want to make sure money is spent wisely, and often in documentary film, you don't know where the story is going to take you, or you might spend more money on production than you anticipated because the story kept going. And so want everyone to, you know, raise as much money to make the film or to distribute and market the film as it costs to make the film, that's just not always possible. So for us, we preferred to come in for documentary once the film was done. You were in color correction, or you were looking at your time, trying to time your festivals, and at that stage, you can come in and start doing the strategy phase and saying, okay, what type of film do you have? How impactful is it? Is it educational? Is it gonna make people angry? Is it gonna put you in somebody else's shoes? And then we'd see what kind of campaign, and what were the filmmaker's goals? Do you wanna raise money for your next film? Do you wanna be on the ground and politically active with this film? And so the combination of the type of film they have and the type of filmmaker and what they want to achieve, that's where you start to put together the campaign.
And would that be like the producer or the distributor that would reach out to you?
It depends. So oftentimes we'd be working directly with the film's director or the producer if they were actively involved in the impact campaign and raised money for it. Sometimes the distributor. So we have a long-term relationship with National Geographic. So we work across all their titles. Who else? Sometimes brands. We worked with Patagonia when they would release their documentary film, so kind of dependent. I think if I remember, it was almost half and half between independent filmmakers and distributors.
Yeah. And let's go from right to left this time. Amy, when would you come typically? So let's say a typical process of getting involved in a film, if there is one. Always wishful thinking that there is a script.
Every film is different. You say the film journey is unique, and so I think film, we come in at all sorts of different stages. It might depend when you've heard about us, and so you might have a great film and you say, oh, I wish I'd met you sooner.
After this talk, everybody.
But, you know, again, sometimes we come in really early, especially when we're thinking about creators, about the story that you want to develop, because even when you're working on a documentary that can take you in unexpected directions, so you still have an idea in your mind of the story and that you want to craft and why you started perhaps following these protagonists or following this situation. And sometimes working with impact strategy at those really early stages can even help you as a creator make decisions about what film you're going to make and where you're going to go, and help you unpack some of those kind of deeper existential questions about what is your film about, what is your mission, what is your purpose. Because also as a documentary filmmaker, if you're going to spend 3, 5, 10 years making your project, you want to know your why. In those deepest, darkest days when it's not going anywhere and you've not got any money and you're feeling like this was just a long process and maybe you should have picked an easier subject, you need to have crystal in your mind, this is why I'm doing this film, because that will see you through. And that's where impact thinking at an early stage can be really helpful to give you that kind of, you know, through line of an arrow. And then sometimes we come in at much, much later stages. And it's similar times to that, kind of just in post-production, and some of the projects that we worked with over the last few years, we've come in just at that post-production stage when the film's getting out into the world and wanting to develop the impact vision connected with the festival strategy and connected with the release and distribution strategy. And so impact and the commercial success of the film, they're also very much handled.
And is there something that's too late? When is it too late to get on board?
I think for the film, you know, we want to make sure that the impact, as I've just said, is empowering the commercial success of the project as well. And so, you know, when you're thinking about how impact can help bring audiences and how impact can sell territories and how impact can expand the opportunities for the film, then that's a really good space to be in. But I don't think there is such a thing as too late for impact. And actually, one of the films that we worked on, which was a film about artificial intelligence, iHuman, which was a documentary made by a Norwegian director, Tonje Hasenshai, in 2019 it was released. And at the time, it didn't have a hugely successful release. It was very successful in Norway. It had a lot of support there, broadcast there. But internationally, we hit a lot of roadblocks. And I think we're going to come back to roadblocks So I might talk about some of those then. But actually, it's just been confirmed now that we are 4 years pretty much kind of down the line that it's going to be on BBC Storyville this coming autumn. And it's actually only now that people are, you know, you've probably all heard of ChatGPT, and it's now a sort of a household discussion. Whereas at the time that My Human came out, in some ways it was almost too early because it was so cutting edge. The film is very much the people that are on the forefront of AI, and it was a film that was almost too ahead of its time. And so some of the impact that we wanted to achieve, we did achieve a lot of things with it, you know, thinking about ethical AI and human-centered AI regulation in Europe. But actually, even now, it can have a second wave of impact opportunity because it's now something that more audiences can connect with and more audiences are intrigued by because of other societal things that have happened in the meantime.
Yeah. And Christy, you wanted to, I think, add something to the timing of the...
Did you ever watch Simon's Next the Why?
No.
No, it's a great YouTube video. We make everyone on our team watch it because you're so right. You have to be like centered in your why. So if you just like YouTube Simon's Next the Why, it's just a great framework for thinking. It's like make sure you have your why with it.
I'm going to use it as well in my campaigns. It's great. Yeah. And it's a difficult question, I think. I mean, it might be simple, but complicated at the same time. Yeah. And I think, I mean, Rory, in the whole process of like producing and distribution, I think participant has its own particular maybe position in that whole process. Could you elaborate?
So I sit on the film side, and we co-finance and produce close to 4 to 5 documentary films a year. We also do narrative films, we do television series, but I sit, you know, exclusively on the doc side. So we do have the privilege of having a campaigns and engagement team in-house. So when we come on board a film, we do. We ask the why from the filmmaker. Why are you making this film? What sort of impact do you want to make in the world? Sometimes those can be two, not necessarily conflicting, ideologies, but they can be different. You can have the film be this beautiful, creative thing, and you can have the campaign be something else that's living and breathing. And I think, again, that's where we have the privilege. We almost call it the fourth act of a film. You need to your point, make it entertaining, make it so that people will actually see it. And also something we tell filmmakers, you know, from the beginning is don't try to encompass everything in the film itself. I feel like that's, again, a roadblock, you know, that we all come up against. You want everything to be in it, but that's the privilege of having a campaign so you can extend beyond the life of the film itself. In terms of timing, so it is early, but I think that it's early ideation. In terms of tactical work, we do, we as a campaigns and engagement mostly, with the work of our team and filmmakers, we start to build out a plan closer to when the film is done, because distribution is key, right? Like we, as an independent producer, we can do quite a bit. We can organize community screenings, we can, you know, we can get the word out there, but ultimately distribution is where you're gonna get the widest reach possible, whether it's a, you know, if you're lucky, a worldwide deal, you know, or it's strategic in that you carve out certain territories and you work with theatrical distributors all over the world. You know, it's building that momentum. I do think starting early is important though, because again, going back to outreach, there are organizations that are already, they're experts in this space. I'm not an expert in climate change, even though we've made so many films in the space. And so starting early gives you a runway, you know, and it makes people aware that a film is coming. And then again, also to your point, it incentivizes distributors. I think distributors, sometimes it can be a buzzword and empty promises, but I think more and more of them are waking up to the fact that it's one, you know, built-in marketing, but also they can reach audiences that they usually would not reach through their impact work.
Yeah.
I would just add one thing to that, sure, which is kind of both of your points around building the community, but also building the vision of the change opportunity. If you're looking at structural and legislative change, those processes can also take, you know, they're minimum like 18 months, sometimes can be 3 years. So if you're looking at targeting some kind of big structural change or looking to change a law or change a policy, then starting early with your impact strategy means that you can have in your mind where you're going, and you can be having behind the scenes conversations, maybe with the legislators. You can be building the strategy around how your film is going to fit into the timeline and of the legislative process. You can stop something you know, at a legislative level before it even gets too far, because you know that your film is coming and you could be using that and targeting that in certain ways. And so you can actually do a lot with your film. You know, we've run impact campaigns with films before they've even been released. And we've done all of the impact on the campaign even before it's been released. And in some cases, we've had that put into the final cut of the film. For example, if it's been a protagonist that's gone there to go and speak at a huge international conference, and the filmmakers wanted to film that and wanted to show that as part of their journey. And that's what impact was created in the film by creating the change.
I think there's two examples that come to mind because you're entirely right. One is Invisible War. If you're familiar with Invisible War, one of the things that Amy, the producer on it, was she took the film from behind the scenes to generals. It's about sexual assault in the military in the US. And before the film was done, she took it like to generals saying, this is coming out, would you like to do something in advance? And there's a great doc called Food Chains, which did something similar. It was about stopping human slavery in the farming for tomatoes. I butchered that a little bit, but you get what I mean. And so they took it to Walmart. They said, we want you to sign up. Like, Walmart, you're going to be looked at negatively in this film unless you agree to this process in advance. And they did. And so you're right. But in both those cases, it was the producers that were very, very actively involved in their campaign, and they had a little bit of political experience.
Yeah, I was going to say, because you're going to have access to these kind of organizations. And is that something that you, as in is part of that impact campaign as well? So reaching out, or you say the producers sometimes have these access, or you look that into that?
In this case, the filmmaker is named Sanjay Rawal from Food Chains. He, I can't remember exactly his background, but he comes from advocacy. And so he knew, he didn't know anyone at Walmart, but just like doggedly went after the right person. I can't speak to Amy and how she got in contact with the generals, but for us, we know we have a great list of nonprofit organizations, so we keep a database. We built up, this is through the lens of Picture Motion, we built up relationships over the years. We also have an impact advisory board where we have individuals who represent different issue areas who work in the entertainment or media division at those big nonprofits, like Planned Parenthood. And so they would help inform who we should be reaching out to. So yes, we would have those relationships and we would do the outreach, but it's typically a little bit later. Love to get it earlier.
Yeah. Yeah, and I guess that it's kind of a constant dialogue then as well with the companies that you have in your network, instead of telling them this is coming up.
And building real relationships and making sure we're bringing projects to them that would resonate with the work that they're doing, and not just say, hey, Celia, we blast this out on your Twitter, we blast this out on your email.
Yeah.
It's here's why this film, why we should work together on this. I think we've seen, and again, I'm more on the distribution side now, but when I was more involved in doing impact work, we started to see a trend of actually paying these organizations. So bringing on a budget so we could pay someone to pay the ACLU for the time, or pay someone else on a board that we worked with. I think it was, I can't remember, it's a climate change organization, but the distributor gave like $5,000 or $10,000 to the org just to be more active in the campaign. And that really helps, I think, goes a long way. And I know not everyone can do it, but if you can have that conversation with your distributor about what's available.
Yeah. And maybe these real connections, I see Amy going like, yeah. But I think that's also, at least I get it as a publicist a lot, and you might get it as an impact producer as well. Like, why should we hire you and why do we need you? Which I think is obvious, just as much as you need a DLP, you need somebody with that specialty. But I'm guessing that that sort of ongoing dialogue with these organizations and with these partners is something that you offer as well to the table, Amy.
Yeah, I mean, I think the reasons to hire an impact producer are many. And I think what's really important is that an impact producer is not a producer. These are two distinct roles and they shouldn't be conflated. Sometimes you can be a producer and also be the impact producer on your project because you don't have a separate impact producer, but that doesn't mean that you're just doing everything under the bucket of the producer. And that's quite important because especially as impact producer is still kind of fairly nascent as a profession and is growing in the industry, to have that recognition that impact producer is a specific skill set, it's a specific expertise, it's a specific focal point within the project, and it's somebody who holds all of these pieces around the campaign, who holds all of these relationships, who does all this strategic thinking, who does outreach, who does engagement, who brings opportunities to the producer. I mean, that's what we do, is we bring opportunities to the producer, but impact is led by the creative team, it's led by the director and the producer, it's what they do. I mean, everything that we did when we worked with, it's also led by the community. A great example of that is the territory that we worked on last year with National Geographic. And actually, that was a film that the director and producer, Alex Pritz, as the director had impacted his bones from when he started the project. And actually they had a really great relationship with WWF as one of their key partners, because WWF had been on the ground. This is a film, for those of you who don't know, that's about the indigenous community in the Amazon rainforest, small indigenous community who are being, lives and livelihoods being destroyed by deforestation. And it's incredibly a powerful artistic piece, but the impact was there in the way that they made the film. They had support from WWF, who gave cameras to the indigenous community, who then filmed it themselves. They became co-producers and cinematographers credited in the film. And they also have a cut in the back end because it's their production. They're named as executive producers, they're all over it. And then, that turned into kind of impact producing teams connected to this. So Mariana Olenja, who's a fabulous community organizer, led very, very much all the work on the ground in Brazil, all the work in the US, and then we worked at strategic levels in Europe and looking at changing legislation and putting indigenous rights protection into EU laws. And then there we were able to bring on a couple of key NGOs who were already very well established in the EU policy space, and so adding to the kind of the weight and the heft that WWF had in that space and bringing other partners on board, and then also engaging with policymakers and kind of doing things like having closed door screenings with policymakers.
Here we are.
And so that's where the producers held the production, and we held the impact production, but it was very, very collective, and the community there as well. It was their voice. They were involved at every stage of the process. They were the ones kind of driving what we want out of the film, and then we come in with our expertise and say, you want an end to soy being used in EU supermarkets, but if you run a campaign that goes to every audience, every screening, and says stop buying soy, it's just not going to work. And so we'll come in and we'll show you the way to achieve your objective is through this strategic approach that says this EU regulation that's going to ban deforestation is coming, and then what we'll do is we'll get indigenous rights protections in that so that you can then monitor your own territories and be part of the supply chain and part of cleaning up the supply chains from the very beginning, and that's a structural change rather than looking at individual members of people who've just watched your film and saying, you're wrong, you should stop doing this. And so, bringing the young indigenous leaders to then speak to the policymakers, giving them the voice, giving them the stage, doing kind of community activism that supported their social media profiles, doing fundraising that helped ultimately build a community center on the ground in, physical bricks and mortar center in Brazil itself, so that they can continue to tell their own stories and train up the next generation of journalists and investigators. And that's what collective and collaborative impact looks like. Everybody brings what they have to the table and comes and works collectively together.
Yeah, amazing. And I think, we talked about this briefly, and everybody probably thinks like, oh, wow, I want these big campaigns, but how do I afford all this? It's a lot. And Rory, is it something you factor into the production budget already? Or where does, I know we're all working in different territories here, so it might be different in the US than in Europe or in the UK. Is that part of your production budget, or where does generally the money come from to set this all up?
So again, we're uniquely positioned to not have to factor it into our production budget. So when I'm looking at new projects, which is a big part of my job, we understand maybe what the campaign will be, but again, that process, we need to go through that ideation process first. So we look at the budget on its own, and then our campaigns and engagement team, as the film is going through its life, then begins to build out their own budget. I completely understand that on the independent side, that luxury is not always there. And so personally, I would build it into your holistic budget. There are sources in the United States, I wish there were much more, but that do have, a sole focus on impact rather than just simply production. I just think, again, in documentary filmmaking, as you all know, you're going to be with this thing for 3, 4, 5, sometimes 10 years. So understanding the full scope of what you want to do from the beginning, even if it changes, I think is advantageous. So if that answers your question.
Yeah, no, I think it's, at least I know from filmmakers around myself that they often think like, I want this campaign, but I don't know where to start, or I don't know how to finance it.
To add though, to also have the, you can pigeonhole it to a number, but to have the flexibility, because campaigns, like life, like the news cycle, change all the time.
Yeah.
So I do think from the get-go, you may have, I want to pass X legislation, or I want to enact change on this level. And then by the time the film comes out into the world, 3+ years later, the world may have changed, or your perspective on that issue may have changed. So also in terms of budget and just scope, I would say be as flexible as possible, like you are flexible with your productions.
Yeah. And Christy, does that typically work for you? Do you, like, who pays your bills?
So it depends. So the distributor, if you're working with a distributor, they typically would come from their marketing budget.
Yeah.
So marketing and PR. If it was the filmmaker, they would raise money through grants. And so I think what I've found or heard is that in Europe, you have more opportunities for that. Outside the US, we don't. We don't do a lot of government funding. There's some organizations that do it. There's, I'm going to start naming that, no one's going to go after them. But Subject Matter is one I'm a fan of, because they only fund marketing and distribution for impact films, so nothing around production. There's a concept of do you guys remember the producer of marketing and distribution, that title? It's like 20 years ago, like the PMD was getting popular. So including in your budget for your film, a PMD, a producer of marketing and distribution. And so it would be an actual line item. So it's not just for your campaign, similar to an impact producer, but somehow that title was allowing people to raise the money better, because it felt more tangible to who they were raising the money from. The cost would range. So I think from a picture motion standpoint, I think the minimum campaign to work on something is like $15K. It's mostly for human time, for the people that are working on this. And it would be focused on building partnerships and distribution. I think I've seen budgets, I mean, it's been a while, as big as like $1, $2 million just for the impact campaign. And those typically are outside participants. I'm not sure if participant ever maybe had campaigns. Oh, Waiting for Superman was a big, that was an expensive campaign in a great way. So it really runs the gamut. I think when we would try and quote, like, what's an average price, we would try and say, do 30 to 50K in fundraising for your impact campaign. That'll go a long way. Those are some numbers, if that's helpful.
Yeah.
If you agree.
Stuff from a European perspective. So, you know, it's broadcasters are looking more and more at impact. So CNZ had a fund for impact this year that was awarded to, I think, 6 projects. And other broadcasters kind of around Europe have put money into impact. We're currently working with Arte on a project. They put 6 figures into the impact. And that's, you know, that's a kind of a new and a growing thing, an opportunity. The various national film funds are also looking more at impact. I mean, many of those have already had impact criteria in the funding, and then just have an explicitly funded impact. They've asked you in your applications for production funding to show how your production is going to be impactful, but then they haven't actually funded impact, which is why we also encourage people to put in, you know, kind of industry standard percentage of a production impact producer in your budget, so that it forces the conversation as well. But it's growing more and more, and there are, you know, there are philanthropic sources around, and in the same way that I totally agree that NGOs, you know, should be paid where possible, but they can also be a source of funding the other direction, because showing them the opportunity that your film can be something that they attach to a massive campaign that they want to run for the next 6-12 months, and you're giving them all of the assets to run a campaign that they would be interested in, then there's opportunities for them to become a funder, and so it can work both ways.
Yeah. So that might be part of your campaign, just as much to look for these partners for some additional financing?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, whenever we're in projects as Think Film, we do what we can to try and, you know, bring budgets. We, you know, we don't want to be like, we'll come and we'll pay for ourselves, because that's not a sustainable model. We have to be changing the industry structurally. Also for everybody, there are many impact producers around the world, and we want the impact producing community to be paid for their work in the same way that a director is paid, or a producer is paid, or, you know, the editor is paid, and the impact producer should be part of that structural change and recognition.
Yeah, so that's something that, like, filmmakers could come to talk to you about as well, like, hey, I would like this, but where do we get the money from?
Yeah, discussion and say, well, this is what I can bring to the table, and this is where we can look, and this is where relationships exist. Brands are also something to consider. With documentaries, you obviously have to be very, very careful when you're engaging with companies, but it can work. For example, we're working with a documentary production at the moment that is Sierra Leone. A young woman who escaped from child sex trafficking and has now set up a surf school on the coast of Freetown in Sierra Leone, which is a kind of healing community and and it will be an educational place for other young women, girls and women. And we're in talks with Roxy and other serving brands to kind of support the impact of the campaign, because they already do work that's aligned with that. That's part of their mission, is how serving can be empowering for women, and how serving can be therapeutic and serving can be educational. And so finding brands where it makes sense, because it's aligned and because you've done your due diligence and you know what you're working with and you know where, like, the arrangements that you're putting in place. And, you know, they're not touching the editorial of the film, but they're supporting the impact. And so it is possible to have those relationships. And I mean, we haven't signed anything with Roxy, so I don't quote me on that at all, because I'll get in trouble. it's an example of a conversation yeah. we're having, and we have other examples where we have worked with brands more specifically.
Yeah.
I also... Oh,
okay. No, I'm good.
I also think the funding, because you're right, it's a very tricky line to toe with brand funding, specifically in the production of a documentary film. I do think the funding of an impact campaign, you know, is quite different. So simply just agreeing with you. And again, I feel like with greater transparency, these brands, again, are waking up, you know, to not only transparency within themselves, but also to support these causes. So, Roxy, that's great. That's cool.
Actually, you're totally right.
Okay, don't quote me.
That is cool.
We also, I forgot about this. Yes, if you can, sometimes it's easier for a brand to do the screening tours, at least what we've found, or the impact distribution part of it, because it's easier to get it signed off of by their team. They're not a brand engaging in political action, because that goes through a whole different department. But they're supporting screening tours. So we worked on a film called First Generation years ago, but the filmmakers did an amazing job of, they did a lot of the research and pitching, but they got Wells Fargo, an American bank, to pay for a 10-city tour where the film went to 4 to 5 high schools in each city, and paid for the filmmakers to go and speak. And from that, they collected additional footage to showcase what their film looked like on a screening tour. And then we used that to then promote other people booking screenings of the film. And yeah, I think it was maybe $200,000 from Wells Fargo. And it was great.
And I guess that also, I mean, credibility is very important there, so that you do make the right connection with the right brand. You say already, like, be careful with these brands. And I'm guessing that that's where you come in as well, where you can actually have a look at, again, the why, and is this the right partner to go with?
Is that brand going to use you to greenwash or whitewash or something in some way? And so, yes, you want to be very thoughtful. Just as they're evaluating you, you want to evaluate that it's the right partnership for you as the film.
Yeah. And do you experience that filmmakers, do they generally come to you with sort of a list of partners already, and you go through them and you're like, yeah, no, yeah.
I agree with what you think. So, no, I think one of the easiest things you can do at early stage is start putting some of those lists together. You don't need to do it to work with us, but it's to be thinking about your campaign and your audience and your action much earlier. Even just creating an email list and keeping your, it sounds so simple, but I'm surprised at how many filmmakers we work with didn't actually have this ready. But have an email list of your friends, your family, your investors, your supporters, and any organizations or individuals you might want to work with, and provide updates. Don't, you know, fill their email inbox weekly, but regular updates and behind the scenes footage. I kind of have a question for Rory too, like how, it's really, really helpful when footage and photos and stories are collected along the way, because one, you can breadcrumb it while you're, on this email list while you're in production, but two, now we have assets to work with,
right?
On the impact campaign part. Yeah. So do you guys work with your filmmakers to do that efforts?
We do. I mean, because again, not everything can be in the film itself. And so we are always telling them, you know, not only once you have the film and it's done, we have a social media team, again, we have a campaigns and engagement team, and then again, in tandem with a distributor, we are creating kind of mini stories or things that, again, cannot be encased in the film itself. A good example is Margaret Brown's Descendant, which premiered at Sundance in 2021 and was picked up by Netflix thereafter. We created a digital series down in Africa Town that focused on the heritage. I should back up. It's about a community there dealing with the ramifications of slavery outside of Mobile, Alabama, a community that their descendants came over from the last known slave ship called Clotilda. And so the campaign was community first. They were entirely center. You know, they had say again in this digital campaign that we, you know, that we, you know, just create it because.
Yeah. I can, as a publicist, I can only champion that, like get all the materials during your production and like use it for your like whole marketing campaign, I would say.
I think just to add to what Christy says, you often don't know how many assets you already have. It's surprising often when we sit down with filmmakers and you start teasing out, oh, you actually know this person, oh, you've got this person in your network, oh, you've already had a conversation with these people. And just because you, as a filmmaker, might have just done all these things kind of scattergun or over a period of time where you're focused on and your focus is in a different place, you often have more in your hands already than you think you do. And when we work with filmmakers and we start, you know, developing impact strategies, I think you also have more of an idea of what you want to achieve than you think you do. But that's the role of the impact producer is to come along and get those things from you, mm-hmm. and then show you how you can use them.
Yeah. So really guiding them through that process.
Yeah.
As well. Yeah. And are there any? I mean, we talked a bit about sort of how these campaigns go. Like, I want to talk a bit about those roadblocks, but also. I want to keep it positive. So what are like the things that people can, so we're talking about materials, so gather your materials during production, make sure that you have behind the scenes materials, think about sort of the why. Are there any kind of essential things that you would like to tell filmmakers to sort of think about or do during the production, Rory?
That's a good question.
Yeah, I know.
I feel like I'm repeating myself a bit, but doing the homework, again, of knowing the people that are already working in this space, especially if you are observing a community that is not your own, and not to say that you haven't already done the work, again, on the documentary side, but in terms of the impact, just being aware of the priorities of the people, again, whether, you know, what are the issues that they are dealing with in their daily lives? So. An example we produced alongside with National Geographic, Matthew Heineman's The First Wave, which was about the first few months of the COVID-19 epidemic, specifically in New York City. And so obviously, I mean, it's an incredible film on its own, but in our canvassing, we essentially were asking the question of what do you as healthcare workers need? And they were saying over and over again, mental health resources, which, is a given, but I think to sometimes you're surprised, right? You think, okay, is this campaign going to be about awareness of vaccines and the importance of getting them? But our campaigns and engagement team zeroed in on something very specific. It was giving tools and help to these people that are helping us. And so that campaign helped to secure legislation and federal funding, specifically, you know, targeted at helping healthcare workers. So I think it can surprise you also along the way.
Yeah,
I think that's such a good point. I was talking to a filmmaker recently, they're still in production and our film, you know, we talked a little bit about impact goals and they're like, to Amy's point, they're like, we really want to reach Gen Z. It's about TikTok culture, it's about mental health, it's about suicide, it's about social media. So I'm like, well, you as the filmmakers are all like 40 plus. So how are you speaking to it? And like, well, we've interviewed a lot of Gen Zers, like, and how involved are they in the campaign? And so like, is there a way you can involve them more? So they're looking at bringing on a few younger women as executive producers or putting together a committee of young people to kind of help weigh in on the film as it's being produced to make sure it hits the right tone. And afterwards, so what do they do with the campaign? How do they actually get this to young people? Because maybe selling it to Netflix won't be it because they don't know if it'll get into the algorithm of Gen Z. Maybe it is splicing it up and putting it in TikTok, or no, because that's counter to their message. But they should be talking to the people they're trying to reach before they finish it.
Yeah, and maybe also envision sort of what, not only why are you doing this, but down the line, 5 years from now, what will make you proud of this kind of campaign?
That's actually one of my favorite questions to ask. Yeah. If you were to look back, you know, 2 to 5 years from now, what do you want to say this film has accomplished? And it helps because we find it's different things for different filmmakers. For some, it is career. It's I want to be able to get funding on my next project, or I want to get distribution on this film. And all that matters and helps. I mean, you talk about this, Amy, getting an award, it really helps the impact campaign. Doing well in theaters improves streaming, which reaches more people, which helps create impact, which helps reach your audiences to create impact.
So it, yes, they'll look back and say, what do you want to happen?
I would add two things, Aaron. One is then you need to know who's going to get in the way of that. And because some of your partners might be partners in some ways, but they can also be counterproductive to your overall goals because they can have their own objectives, especially NGOs can have their own objectives. They can have their own vision of what they want to do with your film. And if you're not in control of the impact, then you can get steamrolled very quickly into something that you didn't really want to be doing or didn't think you should be doing. And sometimes your distribution partners can be challenging partners to work with. I love National Geographic, we've worked with them as well. They're a fantastic partner, they're really supportive of impact. But they really have a challenging aspect is that they don't do politics, which is surprising given the amount of political films that they're involved with. But in both the case that we worked on, it was Oscar nominated 2020 about the underground hospital in Syria and the territory. We had to be, you know, we were looking in both cases. At the cave, we were looking at the young doctor who was in charge of the hospital and kind of getting her freed from her refugee camp, which we actually did. We got her a human rights award and got her out of her refugee camp, which actually what Disney's lawyers could do because we got two governments to negotiate with each other to get her out of that situation so that she could come and represent the film and be there for the entire Oscars run. But they were, you know, there was this whole kind of political thing that we wanted to engage with around, you know, the human rights abuses that were happening in Syria and kind of things around international justice. And they were just like, we can't touch that. No. And so we had to reframe the impact vision that we wanted to accomplish and work with them because they were a great partner and they were, you know, distributing the film and doing amazing things. And actually were really supportive behind the scenes as well in many ways. And similarly with the territory, you know, we were talking about changing legislation and they were like, well, you can't put Disney's name in the press release. And so we were like, well, we've done this event with the film. How are we drafting press releases that don't mention the film when it's the film that's changing things? And it's navigating these spaces and understanding the different dynamics and play is so important so that you can achieve your end result and you can work around this. And then the second piece is how to extricate yourself at the end of the campaign as well. As we talk about, like, you might want something for your next film. As a filmmaker, yes, you should have a next film. You shouldn't be running an NGO. You shouldn't have, maybe you do. Maybe, you know, the 1% of you might find that this film becomes your calling and this becomes the next 20 or whole of your life. And it becomes your mission to then work with this community or to work with this issue. Very, very rare, I would say. For most of you, you've made the film and then you make another film at some point. Maybe it's a continuation of a theme. Maybe it's on a totally different topic. But having strategies in place so that you can extricate yourself from the impact and you don't find yourself running a foundation that's now fundraising or running a charity that's been set up and doing a job that you didn't imagine yourself doing or looking after a child who's now become an unaccompanied minor who's become your friend. You through their education because that's what you do as a good human being if you pay for their education, but now they're your responsibility and of course they're never going to be out of your life. You've spent your life with them, but how do you put professional boundaries in place?
Yeah.
And how do you make sure that you're taking care of yourself so that your impact campaign doesn't become all-consuming? And that's something that's really important to consider because I've met many filmmakers who are so passionate about the impact and are pursuing it for all of the right reasons, and then find themselves down a road that they don't know how to get out of and do the thing that they really want to do and actually which is what they're really best at because that's what they were doing in the first place, which is making films.
Yeah. And is that something then, if it might stop for them, do you still continue? Is there a point or do you agree with the people you work with, this is where I stop?
The case that an impact producer continues. I mean, in some cases you have to be realistic about what you can achieve with the budget that's available. And again, that's a risk mitigation and a roadblock to consider. If you only have a limited budget, you can have all the vision in the world, but you've got to be strategic about what can we do with the resources that we actually have in our hands. Let's not be imaginative and hope and pray that the money comes in and then find ourselves overcommitted to a scenario that then nobody knows how we're going to pay for. Maybe we do something really small and targeted and that's what's really effective. And how do you, you know, you've got to define your success. Because if you don't, in a similar way of having your vision of your creative, if you don't have the vision of what success and your impact look like, you don't have a target that you're running towards, you don't have a finish line. And so it can become an open-ended thing that could roll and merge and change. And for some, you know, if you brought an impact producer on and that's what you want your impact producer to do is to take your film and to go and run with it. And do things, that's fantastic. But if you want to have
clarity on this campaign has ended and I can put that to bed and say, I've achieved this, I have changed this, I have stopped this, I have started this, I've got three companies signed up to pledge this. What is your metric? How are you measuring your success?
Yeah. It's one of the questions I wrote down, so it's a great check. How do you measure your success? No, but I think you have to ask, why are you making this film? But also, and what makes you proud in a couple of years from now? But also, what does that success look like? And when can you maybe put it to rest as a filmmaker? Rory, do you discuss that with your filmmakers?
We do, because again, success, it's so different.
Yeah.
It's so special. And in some ways it's cleaner when it's targeted. If you are trying to pass a piece of legislation. I think the advantage of having something more expansive, I'll just use fooding as an example, you know, looking at big ag, looking at essentially the way, you know, the big food industry is killing us, that was released in 2008. And has continued to be successful for us and the filmmakers. We had a licensing deal with Netflix. It was, you know, wildly popular. Again, it had a second life, essentially. And I bring that up because if you have that ability to have a longer run, I do think then you can start to zero in on different priorities through the years and then pick up some of those organizations that have momentum with your next film, even if it's not in the same. I use food as, you know, like as an example. But I do think these organizations, you should stay in contact with them. So if you do end, say, your campaign and say, I'm done, I'm wrapped, you know, those are still people that you can work with on your second film.
Yeah, and you might be floating sort of in and out those campaigns as well. I mean, with, as Amy said at the beginning, with iHuman.
Right.
Exactly. I
mean, being released a few years ago.
Yeah. You know, we still haven't stopped talking about our war in this film, you know, and we're, how many years on from that now? 150?
Yeah.
Oh, and I should know this off the top of my head. 05? Yeah, because Partizimo started in 2004.
Okay, so it's 18 years.
And then we did, that's a great example, though, because then we did actually a year or two after I started an inconvenient sequel, and we were able to leverage many of those same partners. So again, it's a case-by-case basis in terms of how you measure success, but I do think I guess what I was trying to get at earlier is like relationships are key, at least to our filmmakers and our campaigns and engagement team in measuring that success and maintaining them.
Yeah.
I want to say one thing about the leaving the campaign. One thing that's very helpful too. So when I was at participant, I did a digital strategy. So I did the website for fooding, built the social communities, leave an online presence somewhere so people could still discover it. Bare minimum, you could do a Squarespace site, leave up your resources, trailer, basic your impact campaign materials, any organizations you're supporting. We worked on a film called Lion. It was at the time Weinstein. Company project, and the film, we noticed the website traffic. One of the calls to action was to give money to three organizations. And when the film was released on streaming, we saw the donations go up. So we watched the donations go at every point of being in theaters, getting a press hit. And so we were raising money for a year and a half just because we left the website up and we didn't have any active campaign running. So finding a way to have some sort of online presence remain afterwards.
Yeah, and that can even continue after you probably stop working on it. And so we had the do's. What are the big don'ts? Are there any kind of pieces of advice that you want to tell the people here? Like, this is absolutely an absolute no-go. Big question.
I feel like there's
doing some gossiping.
Make a film, fundraise, do your distribution, fundraise. It's a lot.
Yeah.
So it's I don't know. I'm thinking about the don'ts. Skin of your campaign is so different. If you made your film to create some sort of impact, then it is important. Don't not have an impact campaign, whatever that looks like, whether it's a partnership with one nonprofit, because that's, you know, what you can do from a bandwidth perspective, or you actively fundraise to bring on really incredibly seasoned strategists to do so. I guess the only don't would be don't.
Yeah.
Sorry, don't give up.
Yeah, that too.
Because it can look like you've never failed. There's failure just isn't in the vocabulary. Like you have gone a different direction than the direction you may have initially envisaged, but you've still done something. You've created something. You're moving somewhere. You're going towards a direction. So don't give up, because it can
be miraculous.
Yeah, I mean, documentary filmmakers are tough people. So then, use that to your advantage, I would say. I was going to check if there are already some questions here from the audience, if anybody has some, or otherwise we're just going to continue chatting. Anybody? Oh, we have a, I think we have a mic here. Yeah.
Now it's a little uncomfortable, but okay. So, just to ask this, so for the film crews, are there some set of the rules that they also can do so they can make their own impact while filming? Because I worked on some of it, so it was interesting for me. So I was just interested if you guys had also, for example, I worked on BBC's show that's still not there, so I cannot say the name. We got a whole list of the things how we needed to behave to the nature. We need, I'm from Croatia, so we still don't put the plastic in the plastic. It's all mixed for the garbage. So we also had, we couldn't kill the fish, so we had to find the fish that is like a robot, and we paid it enormous amount of money. So I'm just interested in your projects. Do you have some kind of similar set of rules that you have to obey to do some little impacts, even while filming?
Such a great question.
Yeah, very good question.
And it's a difficult one, but, and I think it's always evolving. I do think environmental sustainability on your set is key. I think we have the privilege as documentarians to not have it. Have 100 people on our set, so maybe it's a little bit easier to be sustainable. I also think we talk about this a lot. You know, there's people go back and forth about, and again, this is to me impact on an individual level about the paying of subjects or participants, and whether or not how you feel in terms of the integrity. I do think whether you are ensuring that someone is compensated for their archive or for the spaces that you're using, you know, while you're interviewing them, for example, I think it may not seem like impact on a huge level, but it is impactful to them.
Well, I think the subject is such a powerful discussion of what it means to be a protagonist. I mean, we don't use the word subject anymore, right? We've changed things. It's participatory. And to be a participant in a documentary, to be a protagonist in a documentary, it's not just in that moment, but forevermore, that was your story. And the impact of that is something you know, that needs to be thought about more and more. And so there's looking after the planet, and I think there's actually a panel on sustainable filmmaking kind of within this industry session, and that's a huge topic in the industry. We run sessions and we talk about this everywhere, and how you make the film is as impactful as what you then do with the film. It's kind of two sides of it. But looking after the people along the way, looking after your crew's mental health, they are being, your DOP is being exposed to potentially some really harrowing things, especially if you're filming some of the deepest, darkest human rights violations as your documentary, and potentially interviewing people who are sharing stories that are incredibly traumatic. And so not only the trauma for them to have to relive their stories, but for people who are then filming that, who might not be well prepared necessarily, if they've come from a nature documentary and then suddenly filming about child sexual abuse, for example.
Yeah.
And so, making sure that your crew are looked after in that one as well.
That's kind of practice what you preach, maybe, as well, yeah.
So in terms of like developing an impact campaign on your own separately, you're a member of the public, you can kind of do whatever you want in that way. You can post on your social, you can say, this is why I worked on this film and the action I want people to take. Can't do it in the official capacity. So if the film is distribution, we work with Netflix on film, it's phenomenal. And we did some screenings for them a few years ago for the film Athlete A. Unfortunately, Netflix is pretty particular about how the brand is used. And so what I love about doing this work is when the film meets the audience and someone organizes on behalf of the film because they're inspired by the campaign, or it's outside of the film's reach. And so sometimes there's restrictions on that by the distributor on what they can do. So we have cases where someone saw the film and wanted to do some things on their behalf, but we had to reach out and say, we actually can't do that because you don't have permission. So I would say, do your own campaign, but from a personal standpoint, and just be careful if it's not an official capacity.
Do you get that sometimes as well? So during production, where a partner gets on board and they're like, we're on board, but these are the things during production that you need to sort of obey, sort of set of rules? Does that happen? That they sort of set on any, yeah, that they set any kind of conditions for being a partner in the impact campaign production?
I mean, NGOs that we work with, yeah. NGOs will have kind of, you know, you have a discussion with them about what it would look like for them to come on board and the ways that they want to use the project, for their own purposes. And sometimes you might get NGOs that have specific ways that they can be visible, or that they might do things that are behind the scenes and they can support a project that they can't. It's kind of similar way to Netflix not having, you know, having very tight restrictions around their brand. An NGO might say, well, that actually will really put us at risk in this particular region, let's say, if we're visible on this film, because you're being very critical of the government, let's say, and so we absolutely cannot be public on this because it will mean we can never work in this region again. But behind the scenes, we could do some things for you. We could make some introductions, or we could, you know, whatever it is, so, you know, making sure that their opportunity to continue work, because, you know, they will be in the trenches for many, many years to come, long after you leave. And so making sure you're not kind of compromising or jeopardizing their situation.
No, I agree. I think on the distribution side, it's a different conversation when it comes to impact partners. But look, you can't do anything without partners. I mean, that's how, again, you find audiences, but we also believe in the integrity of the film and, you know, protecting the filmmakers too. And so in that case is incredibly important in understanding, you know, the specific needs of the region. But when it comes to the actual creative, you know, we do feel strongly in keeping that intact. And so we wouldn't want, again, from an impact partnership side, for that to influence any sort of decision making on the filmmaking.
Yeah, so you need to find a balance as well between what you as a filmmaker want and what you want out of those partners.
It was in the past, like, you can't work with NGOs because it will be seen as an NGO film. Your film will be an NGO film, and you run the risk of your film being seen as propagandist. Mm-hmm. And the lines are blurred, and the lines are shifting, but yeah, having those bright lines was really clear that creative control lies with the director, and that the NGOs are not having a say over the final cut or being able to take scenes out or whatever. Being really clear that this is independent documentary, mm-hmm. and it is not the view of the NGOs that are partners or any other partners that are partnering.
Yeah. All right, I think we saw over here.
Thank you for this wonderful conversation. First of all, I'm sorry if I will make some mistakes in English. I have a question, if it's okay. If it's not okay, you don't have to answer it. It's regarding the independent movie making, in this case, documentary feature. What are the next steps of finished product who has passed many festivals and gained some awards? What are the best steps in the future to gain more publicity or something else from your experience?
I can end there. No, I think, I mean, it is a good point. And I think talking from a publicist perspective, I think an impact campaign is very much part of the campaign that we would run. I mean, Amy and I have worked before on iHuman is one of them that we worked on together, but it is very much an integral part. And I would say in filmmaking, sort of the typical publicity campaign is very much focused on that sort of festival run and your world premiere and sort of the bigger sort of A festivals that follow, and then having more local campaigns once a film is distributed. And I do think that that's where those impact campaigns come in as well. So I often get the question where people like, oh, we want to do this impact campaign, but the only thing they have confirmed so far is a premiere at a festival. And I think that is very much part of the conversation of where is the film going to be screened after that festival and how is it going to impact the impact campaign. But then again, I'm thinking by getting people like these on board that they also might help you to actually shape that campaign of distribution. If that sort of answers the question, yes or no? Yep.
sometimes we'll get calls from distributors at film festivals who were vying to purchase a film. and to kind of get a competitive edge to buy that film, they'd say, hey, we want to put together an impact campaign. We want to offer this to the filmmaker. Can you pull something together quickly? And a big part of that was the audience identification. We believe this film has an audience. We know it's specific to these issue areas. Can you pull together like a landscape report on who those audiences are, where they are, and how we're going to engage them? And so I said that because it was, we love doing those because they were helpful for us. And so that's something you can also, it's research. It's something you could start to put together on your own. Who is your audience? Where are they? Why should a distributor pick you up? And if you don't get distribution, how you already have part of your roadmap to do self-distribution on your own.
Yeah, and probably at least like being very specific about these audiences as well. I know that a lot of times when you have to pitch for funds, for example, you're almost forced to say, oh, my film's for everybody and no film is for everybody. And it's fine, I think, to admit that. And I think the more specific you can be about who you want to target after that festival, because again, like traditional publicity campaigns, they are very much industry focused. So you want to reach more industry partners to get the film sort of going. But so often when you have both a publicist and an impact campaign, I think that sort of enforces each other and sort of become one whole holistic campaign. Is there a question here in front? Yeah.
I was wondering, in some countries like Turkey, they are conservative and also authoritarian, and if you are making a documentary about human rights violations or things like that, so sometimes making an impact campaign put you and your subjects in danger. So what do you suggest in this case?
I can actually speak specifically to Turkey because we've got a film on Turkey made by a Turkish director that we're working with at the moment, which is about women who've experienced domestic violence. A young woman who was a finalist on Turkey's Got Talent, who was actually the subject of a horrific attack. She was shot in the head and she survived but with life-changing injuries. No, it's called My Name is Happy. This is a campaign where this is a topic that's in Turkish society, in Turkish media, in Turkish politics, is very, very difficult to address. There we are focusing on the international dimension as our primary piece of the campaign, because that is a space where these conversations can happen and we can take the Turkish story to the world and show how what's happening in Turkey is also resonant with almost every country in the world. And we can bring attention to the film through international partners and bring many international partners on board. And then that can also then, through the work that it does, go into Turkey as kind of almost phase two. And there it might be something that is more, or rather less public and visible. It might, the campaign in Turkey will be focused more grassroots around supporting women's shelters and supporting those on the ground who are actually doing the work, rather than seeking political and structural change, because that is too risky in this particular circumstance. And so the political and structural change is being sorted at an international level and looking at things like UN Women and the frameworks in the UN where Turkey is part of these international institutions, and so how we can put Turkey on the table in the international fora as a discussion point and use Turkey as a case study and bring other countries into the discussion as well. And then at a national level, it's something that's very carefully structured and targeted, and with a few key partners where it really makes sense. And the film, and that, you know, they're hoping to be able to show the film in Turkey, but even that is a level of, you know, distribution in Turkey needs very careful consideration and strategy around it. So it's, for us as well, you know, having the international partners with that expertise and the local partners who really know the political situation and know very much the risks that are on the ground, so that you are saying, this is too risky, we can't do this. We can come with all these wonderful ideas and you say, no, we're not ready to do that because that will put us at risk. And that's exactly how it should be. And everything is then kind of step by step and very careful. And so sometimes the impact campaign might be entirely behind closed doors. In some circumstances where it's just impossible to do anything that's public, your impact campaign might actually be entirely just having two people that have a meeting and discuss an issue, and that is impact, because they might never have otherwise met and they might never otherwise have discussed it. And that meeting might not even take place in the country. It might even be that it's within the context of an international parliamentary visit to Brussels. And we have people meeting in Brussels and discussing closed room settings. And that is not going to distribute your film. It's not going to be one of those campaigns where the impact and the distribution correlate, and by having a huge social media campaign, you get more audiences and it brings you distribution. But it is going to achieve real, meaningful impact because it is going to actually address the situation, and your film is the reason that is happening. And so that's what I would say about those circumstances where it's incredibly risky. It's that you have to be strategic about what is possible and do something that is where you can have the most impact and move the needle.
Do you get sort of a team of different impact producers that maybe on board as well from different territories? Or is it really...
Case by case.
Yeah.
I spoke about Turkey because of that particular film, so I could kind of use that as an example. But it really depends what your situation is as to who you need to be speaking with. You might be speaking with academic experts, and actually, again, rather than addressing something head-on going into the political, you might bring some academic experts to meet in a university setting and have a hypothetical discussion around the topic. You might bring a more UN situation together, or something that's kind of a framework in which you can discuss a real situation within a kind of more like academic setting. And so it depends what your situation is, but to think a little bit more outside the box, because if what you want to achieve is the impact, then you're thinking about how you're going to achieve that rather than thinking about how you're going to distribute your film, because sometimes those can be two totally separate conversations and questions.
And probably that makes a challenge, or that maybe I can imagine the fun part of the work as well, to really for every specific film making a very tailored approach. I would also guess that the same approach doesn't work twice, because you've done hopefully that one impact campaign successfully. So then about a specific topic, you might get a very different campaign on the same topic, I would guess.
There was an organization called Active Voice, and they, Ellen Schneider, they have developed a framework called horticulture. We talk about this a lot, I love it. Yeah, horticulture, because it's free and available online, and it's just a way of thinking about your film. Is your film going to shock people? Then maybe like keep it close and think about a campaign that's about shocking people coming out the door strong. Or is it, I'm going to follow in somebody else's shoes and live another experience. It's a different type of campaign, so go check that out.
Are there any kind of sort of resources you would say that are available online or to the audience where you would say, go there, like consult that before you're going to start your impact campaign?
No, I was just going to say off the bat, POV has an incredible resource that I reference frequently for production financing, but I do know that, you know, several of the organizations listed there have an impact focus.
I was going to say the Doc Society Impact Field Guide is a kind of Bible in the field. It's, you know, it's incredibly detailed how to, all sorts of different things to think about, and many examples of campaigns that have been run. It's really a foundational guide.
100%, and just reading case studies, searching, and some of the campaigns might be a bit older, and technology is the only thing that's really changed, so a Facebook campaign won't be the same today, but we have as many case studies you can find.
And there's a Global Impact Producers Alliance, GIPA, GIPA. And so that's, you know, a worldwide kind of resource. They are growing as the whole point of GIPA is to kind of bring visibility to impact producers and to empower and resource impact producers in different regions where, you know, impact might be an entirely new, particularly where impact might be an entirely new thing, or, you know, there might not be another impact producer, you might be the only one, so you might be starting impact. And so to not feel alone, you know, join the network. So there's kind of talks and resources and all sorts of things that
people have. Great. Do we have any other questions from the audience? All right. I think we're going to wrap this up in a few minutes. I was just going to ask you just one, if there's one project that you can highlight, if we're going to do some research about some certain projects and amazing impact campaigns, is there one project that you are really proud of, like, look it up, this was amazing what I've done?
I mean, yes, there's a bunch that I love, but the one I want to speak to is one that's active right now, and I think because it's also achievable in some ways. So it's a film on our platform called Spellers. It's a very small documentary film that's about kids with autism who are nonverbal and how they can communicate through this spelling program. And it's the first film that covers the topic so in depth, and it follows and has the participants. To speak to their, literally speak with their fingers through spelling, to their own experience. And they knew their audience so, so well. The filmmakers were speaking to the organizations in autism, particularly for nonverbal kids, well in advance. And they did a few festivals and then decided to forego any sort of theatrical or traditional release to get it straight to those organizations. And they gave it to the organizations to fundraise for, to raise awareness for. They do box office splits. They do charge licensing fees, so they have revenue coming in from the film. But they very much were like, here's the film, here's some resources, but giving it away to organizations to then use the film for their own campaigns.
Spellers.
As it sounds.
Yeah.
I mean. But I've already talked about the territory. The territory is a comprehensive impact campaign. It has so many parts and achieved so many things. And the year one report for the territory has just been published. So that one, but also we work on documentary and fiction, and actually Dark Waters, which was a fiction piece we worked on with participant, is something which we're particularly proud of. I think it's really interesting to think about how documentary and fiction can complement each other as well. I mean, Dark Waters, there was a documentary that had been made about the topic, The Devil You Know, and then it was out of a New York Times piece that was kind of written out of that documentary that Mark Ruffalo read and said, I have to make this film. And then the fiction, Dark Waters became kind of groundbreaking and change-making in so many, many ways. And so also thinking from a documentary standpoint about how, you know, your piece can create impact, but also to fiction has different opportunities and can do different things, and the two can work really well to complement each other.
Okay. Rory?
There are many, it's hard to choose from. I've already talked about Descendant in the first wave. One that's recent that I could talk about all day is Laura Poitras' own Beauty and the Bloodshed. And so in many ways, I mean, the film speaks for itself. It's Nan Golden's fight against the Sacklers and essentially their cause of the opioid crisis, specifically in the United States. The impact there was supporting the work of PAIN, which is the organization that Nan founded to bring the Sacklers to justice. And so again, very targeted, but incredibly proud of the way that we have been able to support the organization. It's grown bigger, the donations have grown bigger, and they continue to fight the Sacklers in court.
Amazing. Thank you so much. We're gonna wrap this up. All of these lovely participants are going to be at the drinks later on. So if you want to shoot them questions, they're also really lovely people. So you can talk to them there and shoot them some questions. But thank you very much. And
thank you.
See you at the next panel.